for example, use, you know, we talk about IoT, we have been using it for a while. We talk about RPA. I think in the last few years, we've got rid of RPA because we automated most of it. And again, for an RPA, the use case should not be running for a year. Otherwise, you are, you know, misusing that RPA tool. You are kind of, you know, but the objective should be to get rid of that robotic process by automating it, right? So I think a lot of that has been sorted. Again, that's a tech that is very relevant for companies that have a very mixed bag of technologies. And sometimes making those transformations or rewriting the applications become very, very, you know, expensive exercise, right? So that tool is again going to stay. I am a big proponent of AI and ML. We have been using it and we have been seeing a lot of benefit out of it, specifically around computer vision. So we can look at a truck image and tell you how much is occupied and how much is empty.
I think in the best interest of time, we can begin. So very happy to see the fraternity here. And I hope you're all in good health and are keeping safe. Thank you very much for taking the time out and joining in during such a difficult time. It's such a big privilege and a pleasure to reconnect with everyone, our distinguished panelists who are handpicked because of the think input and the rich experience that they bring in. And thank you to our distinguished audience for joining us. We've received 200 registrations, most of whom are CEOs and CXOs, senior leaders, and many of them are our members and repeat visitors to our webinars, which is very encouraging and motivates us to provide even higher levels of dialogue through the online modes as well. And for those of you who are new with us today, the Blue Circle is an exclusive community and ecosystem which is curated for business leaders across 6 sectors, which are logistics, e-mobility, energy, real estate, healthcare, and aerospace and defense. We also present socioeconomic insights, which ultimately determine the evolving complexion of the market. And in response to the COVID challenge, the Blue Circle has also accentuated its digital presence. One of the many modes we employ is our weekly webinar series and our digital publication. And in addition to this, and you'll be happy to know that we very recently launched the first version of the Blue Circle app, which is curated for leaders. It's somewhat like the sector-specific LinkedIn for leaders, a space that brings leaders together to have meaningful conversations, connect with each other, house high quality curated content, and also provide access to business opportunities across our core sectors. Those leaders who are interested, please do write to us. I will also share the link to the app in the chat section and will soon be sending out invitations to our select guests post our webinars. We've also begun our selective outreach and have close to 3,000 leaders who joined the waitlist as well. And today, as part of our innovation series, we're privileged to have big minds and leading thinkers of the industry join in for the logistic community's discussion. Topic is innovative technologies redefining logistics industry. In the best interest of time, I will just briefly mention the names and designations and then request Mr. Bansal to please chair the session. We have with us Ms. Anu Singh, Blockchain Supply Chain Strategy Leader, APAC, IBM. Mr. Kapil Mahajan, Group CIO, Safe Express. Mr. Rajiv Dinesh, Head Data Products Delivery. And our chair and moderator for the session is Mr. Neeraj Bansal, Partner and COO, India Global, National Leader Supply Chain Realignment, KPMG. Thank you very much for joining in and welcome distinguished panelists and leaders in the audience. I now request Mr. Bansal to please chair and moderate the session, sir.
Thank you very much, Siddharth, for this. Good afternoon, everyone. And what a pleasure to be here with you today. Thank you for deciding to spend this Friday afternoon with us. We have an excellent panel. And Kapil, Rajiv, Anu, I welcome you again to the session. May I just request, maybe we're starting with you, Kapil, you know, if you could just give a minute and a half, you know, introduction for yourself and followed by Rajiv and Anu.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for having me, Neeraj and Siddharth. So I'm working as a group CIO for Safe Express and its group companies for close to 5 years now. And post that, I've been with IBM, just like Anu here, for close to a decade and a half. And most of my experience is around consulting. It's not limited to a domain. So I've been across domains. And basically, I like architecture. detecting new solutions, and I'm a big proponent of design thinking. Just kind of gets me going in the morning, right? So tech is really important, but strategic tech, I think, is today very functional and very relevant, and that's something that I really enjoy. So that's a little bit about myself.
Rajiv, over to you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for having me on this platform. I look forward to an engaging discussion. So I head data products at Delhivery. And what that means is we are constantly looking at collecting data from every action that happens in our ecosystem and convert it into intelligence that helps us to be more optimum as a company, more optimum and efficient as a company. So that's what I do at Delhivery. I've been with the company for the last 2 years. Prior to that, I've set up two companies that were again focused on using, data-driven companies that were focused on using AI ML to release new efficiencies in the sectors of urban mobility and renewable energy, distributed renewable energy. So I think mobility and logistics are like very fundamental sectors, and there is a huge scope for using data to really unlock a lot of efficiencies in these sectors. That's what we are doing at Delhivery, and that's a very fundamental part of our DNA, and it's been a great journey at Delhivery, and looking forward to share some of the things that we do on this conversation as well.
That's great. Anu?
Hi, good evening, everyone. My name is Anu Singh, and I lead blockchain supply chain strategy and transformation for IBM, focusing on APAC right now. I, very similar to Kapil, I come from a long consulting background, focusing mainly on supply chain and across different industries, across different geographies, very similar to most of the people who would have started their career in supply chain or in consulting at about a decade, more than a decade now. In terms of the key saying or the key work that I do, I try to sort of marry technology with the strategy and transformation initiatives that are ongoing across organizations right now. And again, strategy and transformation in today's world cannot survive or cannot be achieved without thinking through some of the new and emerging technologies that different organizations work with. So that's the key focus area that I work on. And blockchain, I'm very passionate about blockchain as a subject. I've been working in this for about 5-6 years now. I like the whole field of supply chain in itself as well. Thanks, Anu.
Great, Anu. Thanks very much for that. And with this, let me start with a quick context for about 3-4 minutes. And then we can dive into the panel discussion. Siddharth, may I request you to please share the couple of slides that we have? So while Siddharth gets it up, we can move to the second slide there. So essentially all of us, being part of the industry are aware of the, where the information is as well. But just to kind of keep it in a quick context, in today's economy, logistics is one of the most rapidly evolving industry. It's become the confluence of infrastructure, technology, and also new types of service providers. What you're seeing on the screen are like the few areas where the government has its focus on, and it's also set itself some ambitious targets to achieve in the medium to long term. When you look at the manufacturing, the manufacturing has been challenged by problems of low productivity and also the availability of cheaper import substitutes. And hence the manufacturing sector's share in India's GDP has remained range bound for the past 20 years. The graph's not come out well clear. There's some issue with the presentation style on it, but to kind of keep it there, it's about 15 to 17%, has been the share of manufacturing in the India's GDP. And hence India is kind of currently relying a lot on the imports to address the local demand. And to reduce the imports and to get the manufacturing up and running, we need to strengthen the domestic supply chains. And hence, there is a need for a robust logistics sector. And a strong, healthy logistics sector can also help us in improving our India's ranking in EODB further or the ease of doing business, given that it is going to play a significant role as well in terms of if you are moving towards a $5 trillion economy, it needs a very strong supply chain and a very robust logistics sector, there. Siddharth, we can move to the next slide. So as you see from the screen, in order for logistics to make a significant contribution, it will be important to, you know, resolve some of the challenges that the industry is facing as well. India's logistics cost is at 14% of its GDP, which is significantly higher than the global average. Also, there is a competitiveness gap as well of about $118 billion, which is further likely to increase to $500 billion by 2030. It is continues to be one of the most organized sectors also in India. You know, the 80% of the overall logistics spend in the country is currently going to the unorganized sector. And hence, there is a need for, or there is a lot of potential as well for newer ways of approaching the sector. I think while it's given in the bottom, but it's one of the very important elements of you know, the fact that currently in India, it is taking almost 7 to 10 days to reach a port, you know, while in countries in like China, Bangladesh, Vietnam, it kind of takes less than a day to get to the port over there. So which is where there is a strong potential which is existing for usage of newer types of methods, approaches, technology, also in terms of, you know, of course, the seamless integration with the infra as well, which can help the improvement of the sector overall. We can move to the last slide. So with this very quick background, you know, what we'll do is that we'll spend some time in terms of discussing that, you know, what are the different technologies which are there, which is gonna help in terms of improvement of the logistics sector overall. And with me at the panel, we've got representation from the industry as well as from our technology domain as well. So looking forward to a good discussion there. So Siddharth, we can remove the presentation and yeah, thank you very much. So Kapil, if I come to you first, you know, Safe Express has collaborated for a technology major to deploy an end-to-end cloud native logistics platform. So, and do you think that, you know, that the way the pandemic has, you know, kind of forced companies to optimize their core operations, you know, especially like in terms of demand forecasting, price modeling capabilities. Also, there is a threat on, thrust on, you know, bringing more transparency for the customers and partners. So how do you think this is changing for the companies? And, you know, what are the, let's say, 3-4 key steps that companies are taking to meet this requirement?
Okay, so interesting question, Neeraj. So I think, so we are working on a solution, but that was done pre-pandemic. So it was a strategic call in terms of how do we want to build the new technology stack, right? That could help us stay nimble and be as competitive as a startup out there. And hence that journey. So again, that's a journey where multiple partners are involved. And it's again a bespoke development, which in today's world is, not very... very common. People end up taking platforms or solutions or softwares that work for them. But the reason why we wanted to take that journey was to kind of create an architecture that can scale and that can kind of adapt to the business dynamics, especially you know, how India is by design. I think that architecture again is microservices, Docker's, Kubernetes. Right, so there was nothing out there that could fit our need, and hence this journey and hence this ambitious project of building it from grounds up, right? It's been close to a year and a half of journey, and now we've started launching that on the ground. What it'll give us is a very strong competitive edge as to how contracting is done in India in logistics. The flexibility that's needed by every customer today is very different than a global need. Not one size fits all, right? So then how do you accomplish that in some of the packaged products? They don't have that capability. So how do you build for it? So that was, I think, one of the core reasons why we wanted to do it. And I think as an organization today, everyone needs to look at enabling. We all talk about digital transformation in general, and I think it's a very overused word now. But to enable that, you need to have a very strong foundation, Neeraj, right? And just putting certain technologies there or putting few automation tools or, you know, just having a small RPA play is not really digitization and transformation the way I look at it. And having done that for global MNCs for decades, I think the way it's done is having a very strong foundation. And that's what we wanted to lay. And once that foundation is there, then how do you build the business of today, which is all loosely coupled systems of functionality, right? I'll break it down like that, whether it's your CRM or it's your sales function or it's your core operational system. So how do you break it down so that these systems can talk to one another? And it's very, it's easier said than done. So that requires a very strong roadmap in terms of how do you build that ecosystem. And then you start looking at monetizing that ecosystem and start building certain, like, you know, Rajiv spoke about AI and machine learning and his, you know, expertise there. So my mandate or our mandate at Safe Express is that how do we make every business function or every customer journey more cognitive? Right. So when I say, how do we put cognition into every business process or every customer touch point? So that required a new way of thinking, and that required, you know, for us to redo the entire architecture. And today, by design, we are a cloud native company. Right. So our applications are built to perform on the cloud. They are not a lift and shift. It's not about lifting a monolith and putting it on the cloud and calling yourself cloud. When you say you are native, means much more. And it's more painful as a you know, it's a very painful experience to go there as a technology leader. You know, there's a lot of sweat that goes into enabling that. And I think the organizations today need to look at that, right? So how do you enable or how do you provision that backbone, which can then help you kind of grow or compete or perform in this ever-changing dynamic world of today? And also the customer aspect of it, the way customer wants to interact, or the way our, you know, the requirements from business are pretty similar to our personal experiences today. So how does a business kind of cater to that flexibility and that need, which is ever changing now? So, so I think overall, Neeraj, that was the key why we kind of took on this project and how we want to kind of now look at a lot of other aspects, which probably, and again, including certain use cases that we're doing, which will be industry first. Some of them are already there and operational. Some AI and machine learning plays that are being used in the operations on the ground. Some of them are confidential. I can't, you know, disclose, but there are a few I can discuss as the conversation goes forward.
Interesting, Kapil. You know, always a lot of challenge, you know, when you're building something grounds up, but always has its own advantages as well. You know, once it is kind of completed, you know, so, and then look forward to discussing some of the aspects, you know, as we kind of go through the discussion as well. Rajiv, let me bring you here. You know, Delhivery has a platform to formulate actionable insights using various sources, understand, including GPS trace points, user addresses, delivery coordinates, and also connected devices you're using right now. So in this scenario, how have these technologies added more value across processes, and especially around, I think we've lost Rajiv for a moment. You know, so Anu, let me come back to you. Let me go to Rajiv a bit later. You know, so you know, kind of related.
Am I audible now,
Rajiv?
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. We can't see you, but you are audible. You're there. Okay. So,
got it. Maybe you can go to Anu. I'm because I'm able to see the video quite clearly. So I'm just surprised.
Okay. No, so maybe let's continue with it. We can hear you well. You know, so I was saying that, you know, in the scenario in which you're using this platform currently, how this technology is basically adding more value across processes and function, especially around making agile and informed decisions.
Right. So let me talk about broadly the philosophy about technology and data, right? So, of course, I really laud the effort that Kapil and team have taken to become cloud native, right? That's a great recognition of the future direction of this industry. For us, we've been fortunate to be born and brought up in the era of being digitally native, right? So right from the beginning, the hypothesis or philosophy of the company has been that operate at scale to unlock certain efficiencies, certain capabilities in terms of cost, in terms of speed, etc. And while doing that, continuously build the technology that enables all these transactions to happen, you know, be properly recorded to generate data, use that data to build intelligence, and finally use that intelligence to drive further advantages to the scale at which you're operating, right? So in apart from the simple economies of scale of operation, how do you make those operations smarter, more efficient, more optimal, right? So that's been the philosophy right from the beginning. And like I mentioned briefly, right? So there are three aspects to it. One is building intelligence, understand, having like a lot of visibility about what is happening in your ecosystem, which can be both, which is broadly in terms of knowing what is happening currently, as well as being able to predict what is likely to happen, or being able to predict the attributes of something like an address or a product, right? The second pillar would be in terms of optimizing the network itself, right? So what should your network look like? What should your facilities be, connections be, whether it's last mile or mid mile? Like, how do you build that? Where should your warehouses be, et cetera? And the final part is the most challenging. It's like the holy grail, which is the system orchestration. And when I say holy grail, obviously we already have system orchestration in place, but how do you make it closest to the theoretical maximum of optimality, right? So, and when I talk about system orchestration, you already have a network that you've optimized. You have certain facilities, certain connections, in place, certain warehouses. Now, given a certain load that comes in, right? So how do you optimally treat that particular load? And why is it important? As a 3PL for us, we are working with thousands of clients of absolutely different sizes, right? And demand, especially the last year, has been a great eye opener that, the changes in demand, changes in embargoes or movement restrictions in different states or for different types of goods, right? And a lot of the e-commerce companies that do parcel delivery, we obviously have a full stack of solutions that most people are not very familiar with, because we are famous for the parcel deliveries from e-com. But e-com, for instance, has a very variable pattern in terms of their sales, in terms of their peak and low periods. Similarly, traditional industry have their own seasonality, right? So there is always a change in what is coming into my network today. What are the tasks we need to do today, right? And being able to do that most efficiently, right? So that is the system orchestration part of it, knowing whatever intelligence we have, having already optimized the network. Now, how do we further optimize things for both the cost reduction and obviously the service level, right? So the reliability, the safety of goods, and the ability to complete our deliveries in time. So that is the broad objective. And from a perspective of different areas that we try to build intelligence, so we try to build intelligence on location or addresses, right? So I mean, that's a very major challenge in both India as well as most developing countries. One that people, there is a structure of addresses has grown very organically across different areas and has a lot of historical bias to it as well. So there are very different ways of writing addresses in different parts of the country. A lot of the users, especially in e-commerce in India, for instance, they are not used to writing addresses to a certain level of quality. And also, even in terms of businesses, they're used to a very manual interpretation of how addresses are written, right? So there's not a very good structure, but it is interpretable by a person who is locally present, right? And what we do is we take these addresses, we disambiguate them to a very large extent, right? And we continuously use our the GPS trace on every mobile phone that every person on the last mile or the mid mile carries, right? So we use those GPS traces to keep enriching our understanding of geography, right? So we are able to, whether it is routing a shipment through the network, whether it is deciding which shipments to aggregate together, or whether it is deciding which last mile dispatch a shipment should go on. So this kind of intelligence helps a lot. Then similarly, on the product side or the network side, we are able to understand whether a product is, for example, a dangerous good, whether it can travel by air or not, right? And whether it's liquid or fragile and requires any preferential treatment, right? What is the weight or volume? Because again, working with thousands of people, we don't always get the best qualities of product description, right? So we need to be able to understand this to give it the right and most compliant treatment. Then on the network side, ETAs, whether it is at a city level or it's at a highway level. So what is the expected time for different shipments to come? Because that gives us the visibility that we can provide to our clients, eventual consignees. It also helps us to respond in terms of service level recoveries, right? So network is one part. Customer intelligence also another part where we are able to understand, you know, whether certain customers is a commercial customer or a residential customer. What are their availabilities? What is their likelihood of, you know, what is the ease of delivering a shipment to them? And we are able to optimize things in our last mile accordingly as well. So that's how we use, you know, so we collect every shipment in its life cycle from right from the first mile to the last mile. We'll have like 20, 25 different status updates. We'll be continuously getting, you know, collecting data from the facilities, including where each the specific square foot where every shipment is placed, for instance, right? And every vehicle, every resource carries a mobile phone that gives us the movement information. Where are they geographically right now? And there are a lot of things in terms of time and location that we can learn, right? So that's how we use technology and data to not only build a system that is optimally designed for the load over a period of months, but also something that continuously changes the operations based on the, you know, emerging requirements.
So thanks, Rajiv. You spoke in quite detail in terms of, you know, that how the data is kind of getting used right now, and the method also, you know, from process as well as from an operations, and also how it's helping in, you know, from a growth perspective also on the activity side. Can I just request you to touch in a short way on the aspects in terms of that, how are you looking to minimize the risk of like digital fraud, cyber attacks, and other issues which are also coming in from a downside perspective there?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that is something that everybody, I mean, so as people move on to the cloud, so you see different people who are trying to, have malicious intent in, trying to either scrape data or perform some other kind of hostile activities, right? And it's a part of being cloud native that you need to be very, very cognizant on two fronts. One in terms of privacy, because privacy is something that is becoming very important, and it's a great thing that is happening across India and the rest of the world. So one in terms of data, how do you use internally as well? How do you make sure it is secure, and how do you use it in the right way? So that is one important part. And the second part is cybersecurity, right? How do you prevent any infiltration of your ecosystem, right? So we continuously, so it's a mix of two, three things. One is continuously performing audits of your system. So vulnerability assessment and penetration test, right? So VAPT testing to be done on your system to understand how secure they are. The use of encryptions. For example, we don't store any personally identifiable data in its original form. They're all encrypted, right? There is obviously some level of AI and automation there as well. So we can, as you detect different kind of anomalies or attempts to breach your security, you can continuously, there are tools that are available, and there are tools that you can build that are continuously learning how to detect those kind of patterns, right, that precede or happen during any kind of attempt. And the third part is kind of building it in the DNA of the team itself, right? So no matter how many security measures that you have, the having that culture of people who really value both the privacy of individuals and the integrity of your company in being able to fulfill all the promises of reliability, security, transparency that you want to give to your clients and consignees, right? So as a DNA, we keep working on that. We keep sensitizing people. We keep helping them know about latest attempts, kind of threats, and keep incorporating the best practices in the way that we do our development work itself. So broadly, I mean, those are the three areas. So the periodic audits, structurally building the system to be to have different isolations and of data, different encryptions in place. Third is in terms of actually sensitizing your teams, building, upskilling them to be able to take care of vulnerabilities, etc., continuously. So those are broadly the areas that we look at.
Thanks, Rajiv. Kapil, there's a follow-on question which one of our audience member has also posted. So while I would have come to it a bit later, but what he's asking is that the what are the business capabilities that you are looking to develop based on the IT initiative that you are currently running, the platform that you spoke about, and also if there's any reaction you have to what Rajiv has said, please. And Anu, I'll come to you just after this.
Yeah, so I think just adding on to Rajiv, what he was talking about. So analytics is a very matured practice within an organization. At any point, we have about 1,000 odd employees that are logged into the platform, right, Neeraj? And I have run analytics practice for global companies, Fortune 500, and that's a sizable number of users, right? And why they are hooked up is because within our organization, we today talk about data. We talk on data. We don't talk on guessworks or what am I feeling about the business. Everything is data driven within the organization. So we run BI platforms. We have the capability to today do. We have already moved from predictive to prescriptive analytics, right? So which means that we can not only just predict, we can also prescribe what can happen in the future, and then we can make informed decisions based on that information. For example, we use IBM's weather platform, right? So we are directly interface with IBM weather APIs to predict an impact of a weather based on the 72 hours of data that comes through, the globally deployed satellites that are owned by weather company, right? So there's a lot of, so you can understand the moving trucks and the moving weather pattern, and how do you, kind of interlay the two and then come out with prediction whether certain consignments will get delayed or not. Again, that's not just the only bit. It's also the fact that if there is a rainfall, then what is the level of rainfall that really impacts a truck's movement? If there is a light thunderstorm, it really doesn't impact. But if it's a bigger weather issue, then it can have an impact, including snow and other things that are there. And again, because of our reach, so we do the maximum pin codes in India, Neeraj, next to the Indian Army. So, and through our own network. So that's our key capability. And that means we run consignments or we ship at locations that might not have an internet, right? So there's a heavy investment that we have done on edge computing, because how do you make the devices smarter if your edge points are not connected? So that requires these AI and ML models to run on the edge devices, right? So that's the level of intelligence that has been built. And again, I think coming back to your second question, which was, what are we doing? I think you said more specifically for the customer, Neeraj, was that the...
Business capabilities that you're developing using this platform.
Right. So this platform that I spoke about is the core ERP system. So that can give us capability to do contracting in any way. For example, today in our system, a pin code could have 10 attributes or 2000 attributes. Right. So imagine a pin code that's located in a area which has malls, or in an area which is a wholesale market. There is a different cost of delivery in a mall versus a wholesale market, or to a residential or to a business establishment. Right. Because you might have to use smaller modes of transportation. In a mall, you are constrained by the timings when you can deliver. You can't deliver during the regular mall hours. Right. So this kind of a capability will be added value for the customer, because we'll be able to price the contracts in a very, very flexible manner, right? And which could be very advantageous for the customer, right? So that flexibility today is not available in India, right? So even globally, global contracting in logistics is done in a specific way. And again, we are a B2B company, Neeraj. So we are not a parcel delivery company. We are an express freight logistics company, which means we are very specialized within the logistics domain, and we do express freight business, and all our customers are enterprise, right? So they have a different set of problems. Like Rajiv spoke about addresses. In our world, that's not really that big a challenge, right? So if I have to deliver to Tata Motors, I know where those addresses are. And a lot of those times it's repeat customers that we work with, right? But we still have the intelligence to do the geocoding. For example, how we use this technology, like IoT, we have thousands of devices that are on the IoT platform, including 7,000 GPS devices. All our handheld devices are on an MDM, which is a mobile data management tool. And at a push of a button, we can disable a device, or we can push updates across India, right? So what we do there is very different than what probably Rajiv's use cases are because of the nature of business. So where what we do there is that if I am delivering to a customer, say Samsung, then I want to know if 100 boxes were delivered, did our delivery associate deliver it within the premises, or did he kind of, you know, deliver it or do the scanning outside and then hand it over to the customer? So we have that intelligence to say whether the delivery norms or, you know, SLAs or SLEs were kind of adhered to or not. Because if you look at it, all our model is entirely franchisee. So, you know, we need very strong technology to manage and create a wholesome experience for different franchisees that we have, whether it's booking, whether it's, you know, the delivery franchisees, whether it's the lorry hire or the truck vendors, right? So orchestration of that technology tidbits is really important. And as Rajiv said, we have also about, you know, any packet in our system is scanned 10 to 12 times on an average, right? And with respect to GPS, the GPS pings that come to us is every 6 minutes. So imagine the amount of data that we look at, and we just run it on a big data platform and then do analytics on top of it, right? So we can today do a lot of prediction. We can predict whether a hub will get choked or not because of, you know, the way how the goods are moving on the ground dynamically, because there are floods in certain areas, right? So we can predict whether we need to engage a market vehicle before our own vehicles get, you know, maxed out because of how the goods are moving into the incoming hub and what is the capacity of trucks that are lined up out of that transshipment location. So I think a lot of those benefits the customers will see on the ground in terms of improved SLAs, in terms of, you know, our commitment of being providing timely delivery and being a custodian first kind of a philosophy that we have for our customers. And also this year, there's a lot of focus around customer tech. The customers will see a lot of those visibilities being available to them through our platform.
Wonderful. I think we got a good perspective, Kapil, from you from a B2B side of it, and Rajiv also shared, you know, from a different dimension on the industry, the challenges and how, let's say, various technologies are coming to get adopted and also used as well there. Anu, if I come to you, your views on, additional views on the adoption of technology in this area. And then second, in terms of, as you've been in this domain for long, if you can also highlight some of the roadblocks that you see. We've talked so far on the positive side of it and, you know, the adoption, which has happened already. But as the companies are adopting that, what kind of roadblocks do you see come across, you know, when your clients, when you're looking at in terms of, implementing these technology solutions?
So I'll answer it in two parts, right, Neeraj? I'll answer the adoption of technology first, and then I'll talk a little bit about some of the trends that we are seeing in ways different organizations are adopting these, transformations that they are driving within their organization. So one of the key pain points or one of the key challenges that typically organizations in their supply chain areas have had has been basically the accuracy of forecasting itself. So that's again something that has been a challenge, especially across multi-tier organization where your procurement process is not just coming from the next tier of your supply chain, but could actually almost drill down or trickle down to 3 to 6 levels of your supply chain itself. So in an environment like that, where you're not just dependent on your first level of, first level for your procurement processes, but go ahead to 5 to 6 layers, we have typically seen that forecasting and the accuracy of forecasting itself has become quite a big challenge. And the way we've seen some of the organizations, bring this together is by coupling all these multi-tier procurement functions across the supply chain. So where it helps each and every participant who are tied together in terms of bringing all of them onboarded to the same platform or to at least share some of that data with each other, which kind of enables, let's say the supplier side to understand that there is going to be a business opportunity that is going to constantly keep coming to them, and they do their planning accordingly. That goes on again to the manufacturing organization, where they know that they can again conform to their demands in the market for a certain period of time. So that's one area that we've seen. The second area that we've seen is typically the relationship between supply chain and finance in itself. Now, typically, if you look at across industries. One of the largest challenges which is there in the financing function is the dispute that these organizations have today in their entire supplier network. And every time we've gone ahead and had a conversation with a CFO, one of the biggest things that we hear about is that I want to reduce this number. I want to bring the disputes down. That's the bottom line I want to touch. And how do you do that? So most of the time, the biggest myth that technology has been able to break is that these dispute functions are not a finance function, but actually a supply chain function. So these disputes that arise during your invoicing function, through technology and through near real-time resolution of that discrepancy in your supply chain itself, would basically what it would do is it would preempt any dispute that comes in future. So that means what it translates to is enabling these organizations through the technologies that we've all spoken about, AI that Raju spoke about, blockchain, where we work in. So all of these technologies coming together, first of all, identification of any discrepancy in the supply chain itself in near real time. Now, when you identify the discrepancy in the near real time, you have your operations team, it's themselves, resolve these discrepancies in near real time before it even can hit a dispute and become a dispute in your finance functions. So that's the second area that we've seen a lot of work happening around. The third key area where there is a tremendous change that you're seeing across organizations again is the whole concept of traceability, right? So we've been all talking about traceability for quite some time around, and this is again across industries, whether it's for your conflict materials, whether it's for diamonds, food products. If you look at a lot of the products that even consumers are consuming today, there is how do you reduce your counterfeit? How do you make sure that the alcohol you buy is not as pure as alcohol? So I'm giving you a range of examples from across industry. And there has been quite a lot of demand in terms of how do we understand this traceability of these products coming through. And again, that is another area where technology has played a significant role in terms of not being able to prove that traceability earlier versus what we are able to do today. Almost going to a SKU level detail and being able to identify at SKU level detail each and every component that goes into manufacturing or building that product, or if it's the food industry where that product is coming from. So that's the third area where we generally have seen quite a bit of work going around. The fourth area, again, which is very interesting, is how your quality inspection is being done. Now, quality inspection, again, has been quite a, I would say it's been a cost to the organization where we've not been able to do much over the last few years because of the nature of the quality inspection as such. There was still a lot of quality inspection that was being done manually. And the shift that has happened there, again, through some of the new technologies that we work with, is to, again, automate that the whole quality inspection part of it. And what that means is now I can actually do a high quality inspection of a much larger volume of my products at a much higher speed. So essentially, I'm enabling organizations to do is you are churning out much more volume with a greater assurance of quality in a much shorter time, right? So that's the fourth area that we've been seeing coming out quite some time. Now, and again, tying all of this together, the key idea here is that supply chain as a function was not in the forefront of bringing value to these, a lot of organizations in the last few decades. And that has changed tremendously. So what we have also started seeing is that we've started using technology to be able to improve the overall supply chain efficiencies and the values that we talk about today, which essentially translates to you being able to give value to your customers or your end users themselves. So that's the first part of the question, Neeraj. And could you repeat the second part as well?
Second was regarding when you are implementing these technology solutions, with the clients, what are the barriers to the adoption that you see, or the roadblocks for change in operating model that you see mostly happening?
Yes, thanks, Neeraj. Thanks for refreshing that question again. So there are 2-3 levels in which we've seen challenges, and I guess this is again something that I'm sure all of us have experienced. And these challenges have come at multiple levels. I'll talk about the biggest challenge that we see, especially with some of the older organizations who are, sometimes set in the ways. where you see that there is already a large landscape of discontinued or fragmented applications, both homegrown or acquired or implemented applications that these organizations have kind of put together in place over a period of time. And this could have happened over decades. And with the requirement of agility that the market is demanding right now, these applications have not been able to put that, being able to deliver that value in terms of agility. And the biggest challenge that we see there is the unwillingness to let go of that application. So it's almost like a sunk cost where you need to understand that, okay, we've already gotten the ROI that we needed from those applications. And now it is time to let go of that and start like a blank slate. And this is what we were talking about earlier as well, that sometimes a blank slate while might sound quite scary, but at the same time, the possibilities of starting with a blank slate is much higher. That being one. The second, again, in terms of the nature of the, the nature of the people that work in these organizations as well. And this again, we sometimes over a point of time become tied to the way we are used to working. And that adaption to change itself becomes the biggest barrier in terms of adapting to a new technology. So in a lot of these organizations, what we've seen for a lot of clients that you kind of make it larger than life in your head. Every time we talk about AI or blockchain or data cloud, you sometimes you've made it so big in your head that you don't realize how easy it is going to be once you have it in place. So that is the second part of it. Now, with that, the third part of it is, I would say, some of the regulations that is being driven by either the government or that industry itself, right? So sometimes also before you adopt to some of these new technologies, there's always a constant requirement of working with your local bodies, your standards, setting these standards in place, adhering to some of these standards in place with the government bodies, and getting that becomes your one of your biggest roadblocks again.
Sure, Anu. Thanks for that. So Kapil, if I come to you, the one aspect was to say that, if you have any quick reaction to what Anu and Rajiv just shared on it. And the second was in terms of, when you look at the technology adoption, which is happening currently, or innovation that are happening, which are the one or two areas that you think would have the maximum impact? And, something which you feel are most excited about when you look at in a near future of, let's say, 2 to 3 years around it, what would be those?
Sure. So I think to Anu's reaction, I totally echo what she said. I think a big challenge in blockchain implementation and logistics in India is how do you kind of, take it to a larger audience, right? So how do you build that trust mechanism, right? So if you look at certain projects that were successful, whether it was the Singapore Port Authority that kind of built that blockchain, I think IBM did that project. But that was driven by a body to bring the organizations together with the sure focus around increasing efficiency and visibility, right? So here, I think the bigger challenge for blockchain and logistics is that how do you get some of these parties to sign on your block? Because at the end of the day, it's a distributed ledger, right? So until that mechanism or that trust is built, people will be hesitant to get onboarded. And I think, like Anu said, the government has a big pivotal role to play here. For example, we have eBay Bill now in India. We have e-invoicing. So when eBay Bill was launched, we were the first company in India to directly interface with NIC, right? So we have a direct integration without any GSP or an ASP, right? But that gave us the capability and a lot of advantages operationally, because now all the data that a customer, whatever shipments they're moving, all that information is on a government site entered by the customer, right? And we could use some of that data and make the whole process more efficient, right? So the data entered by our people could be now validated, the GST numbers could be validated, right? Because those shipments are, now we have another source of data to validate against what we have captured in our systems or our internal ERPs. So that brings in a lot of efficiency. So I think government has a big role to play when it comes to blockchain, specifically in logistics in India. I think in finance and a lot of the banking sector, it's already rolled out and being used extensively now. And So that's my bit around that. In terms of, I think the emerging technology, I feel there are a lot of those, Neeraj. I mean, we, for example, use, we talk about IoT. We have been using it for a while. We talk about RPA. I think in the last few years, we've got rid of RPA because we automated most of it. And again, for an RPA, the use case should not be running for a year. Otherwise, you are, misusing that RPA tool. You are kind of, but the objective should be to get rid of that robotic process by automating it, right? So I think a lot of that has been sorted. Again, that's a tech that is very relevant for companies that have a very mixed bag of technologies. And sometimes making those transformations or rewriting the applications become very, very, expensive exercise, right? So that tool is again going to stay. I am a big proponent of AI and ML. We have been using it and we have been seeing a lot of benefit out of it, specifically around computer vision. So we can look at a truck image and tell you how much is occupied and how much is empty, right? And these are variable size truck containers, so they could have different length. So reading the number plate to then finding the dimensions to then looking at the data and figuring out, or looking at the image and then figuring out how much is relatively empty, is a complex data science problem to solve. But these are interesting data science problems to solve, right? So, because that gives you the actual, so I can talk about weight and I can talk about dimensions, but it's very difficult to predict how much of the space of a vehicle is occupied, because you could have things like a bumper of a car to a small packet, which is very dense. And no matter what tool you use today, you will never get a picture until you load it, right? So unlike shipping industry where containers and everything is standardized, in India, things are not standardized, right? So you are living with this whole set of variables, and trying to make sense of it is easier said than done. So this is where AI and machine learning will really come to play, right? And I think that is going to be a very important, overall piece in terms of how organizations of tomorrow will be built. And as I said, cognition for us is really the key mandate. How do we make every part of our business cognitive? Whether it's scanning a particular piece of paper or an invoice, to complex problems like allocating or trying to figure out what is the best place to open the next hub now, right? So I think those are some of the emerging technologies that would really make a big difference. And again, blockchain, I think Anu touched upon. I think it's already being used. How we use in logistics, it'll be interesting to see. But I still feel that you need some government intervention for that to really unlock in a big way within logistics.
Sure, Kapil, we'll come to that. We'll discuss blockchain also for a couple of minutes, just anything. Rajiv, just coming to you, what are you most excited about, from a new tech perspective? And also, if there's any one challenging area that you believe is, significantly there, but, is unresolved, if you could just highlight that as well.
Yeah. So I'd actually like to connect this to something you presented in your slide, right, about the use of technology for reducing the cost of logistics, right? So, and I think we all recognize from an economy perspective, I think that is going to be the move to an organized sector and being able to bring those costs down is going to be a significant contributor to growth going forward, right? And just connecting to that, so what, the way, and just like to make sure that the audience is correctly informed in terms of, so we are not just a parcel company, but we also do LTL. We are one of the market leaders in less than truckload movements. And similarly, we do full truckload as well. We are doing cross-border movement as well as warehousing. So we have very large white goods companies that have outsourced the entire supply chain to us. And what we see is broadly this high cost and this inefficiency that we talk about, right? So it is because of two factors. One is not very good utilization of resources. So the number of empty trips that are going on in the country and the average utilization of a vehicle, right? Or the average turnaround time of a vehicle. So you may wait for a week and make sure the vehicle is completely utilized. But then that if you think of a vehicle almost as a consumable, it's getting underutilized. And that is pretty much one of the big problems that we are trying to solve in a multiple ways, right? So one of the things is, for example, our parcel business requires a certain service level, requires a certain turnaround time, right? And when we build a less than truckload business, we provide the best timelines because we are actually cross-utilizing the same resources, the same vehicles to move the less than truckload, the B2B goods as well. So while we are forcing ourselves to move that very quickly, we are working across different streams of demand to ensure that the utilization is very high. So overall, we are bringing, from an ecosystem perspective, we bring more efficiency into it. We are bringing down the cost. We are increasing the speed. So, right. So obviously, and simply the utilization of the vehicle, not just on a trip level, but how frequently it gets used and how much throughput that it has. Right. So I see technology being, that's what I'm really excited about, continuously pushing on those optimizations, right? So for an instance, the timing of a truck, the specific goods that go into a truck, they're all determined by considerations of obviously space and the stacking, which Kapil talked about. It's a very challenging problem. It's a great problem that is being solved, attempted to be solved across the world in terms of being able to understand the utilization very clearly using vision. But using inputs like that, making sure that your service levels are not disrupted, making sure that you are prioritizing the shipments that need to be delivered on time, having mixed bags of parcels which are bound for different locations. How do you optimize all of that, given the situation today? Make sure you use the minimum number of trips to do that. Make sure you're sending it at the right time. Make sure you're delivering it at the right time. So all these kind of things lead to efficiencies for us as well as for people who participate in the ecosystem. And I like to think of logistics not as companies or fleets now, but I think what we need to think of is logistics in terms of ecosystem. So something that Anu also touched upon, right? When we talk about blockchain. So we need to think of ecosystems where multiple participants can participate, whether I have a small fleet, whether I have a small requirement for shipping, whether I have a space that can be used as a warehouse, or I'm a guy with a bike who's willing to spend, say, 3 hours of my time to help in, to earn some extra money, say, pocket money or extra money in addition to my job if I need that financial incentive. So how do all these people come together in a way that ensures better utilization of the resources, right? And that is the amazing technology problem, right? You can't just bring someone on and make it more expensive as a company to be able to do that. It doesn't work for you. It doesn't work for your client. It may not work for your consignees if the reliability is an issue, right? So how do you bring in utilization, efficiency, and the flexibility of working across? So we don't, we have a very small fleet that we use for benchmarking and for trying new experiments, but we are working with different fleet owners. We are working with different facility owners for our warehousing, different facility owners for our hubs. We are able to work in the form of an ecosystem. And in fact, the great thing bringing all these teams together, we've set up a team in Seattle that is building a very completely abstracted, generalized platform for logistics, which can be used across different geographies, across different compliance and regulatory frameworks and abstract, whether it is, you want to think of a boat being used in Venice for transportation to bicycle rider in, or a foot rider in India who's willing to deliver shipments, or somebody at home who says, I have some extra space, why don't you give me shipments, I'll deliver to the next 5 societies around me, right? So how do you bring those participants in? So we are building that platform which generalizes everything. We'll think of it as an operating system for logistics, and for different geographies, different business contexts, different people will be able to, we will be able to create apps that customize the requirements of different people, and also help them not only to use the technology to make their part of the ecosystem more efficient, but also to participate in a larger ecosystem, right? So my fleet can not only, I can manage my fleet better and optimize my timings, make sure the fuel consumption is all right, but I can also plug into the larger ecosystem where this fleet gets utilized either by my own demand or I'm able to provide it to cater to demand that somebody else may have during a search, right? So that platform is, I think, a great thing we are looking forward to that is being built right now. And we will start seeing it in action, parts of it in action very soon.
Interesting. Lots to look forward to. With this, let's spend about 5-10 minutes on, because there are a few questions that have come up also on blockchain. So maybe we could spend about 5-10 minutes on blockchain, and I'll start with Anu first, and then come to Kapil. Your views, you said that, blockchain does require the government intervention. So, some view that you could share on that. I think, Anu, if I come to you, could you help us with, let's say, 2-3 use cases, from a blockchain, from an India application point of view? There's a question that I have, from the audience, which basically focus on the, food supply chain over there, to say that, it's being used in the developed countries, how that can be used in India. And there's another question, which is to say that, is there any scope to reduce inventory carrying costs by improving forecasting or using blockchain for improving forecasting? So over to you, Anu, for your views.
Yeah, Neeraj, for the first question, where we want to talk about how this technology is going to be used, especially for the food sector of India. Now, I've been working very closely, and this is a topic which is quite close to me in terms of the amount of time I've just spent talking to the different bodies in India around how this is going to impact and bring all of this together, right? So again, the food industry of India is not just, it's a accumulation of many industries in itself, right? We have the dairy industry, you have the vegetables, you have your processed food industry. All of these industries are quite correlated to each other. Now, the first key thing that we have, or the first key challenge that comes in this industry, is that it's a very unorganized industry in itself. A majority of this industry is still highly unorganized. So how do you start organizing some of these different players of the ecosystem itself? Now, one role that the government is going to have to play is that even within India, we have multiple government bodies itself, right? You have your you have your NDBR, you have your your dairy industry of India for food, you have your FTA. So all of these different industries, first of all, will have some role to play when we start looking at putting this ecosystem together. Now, there has been quite a bit of conversation that's been going on with the India government in terms of how do we see this all getting structured and coming together. The first key role that the government will have to play in setting up the network itself is, first of all, identifying what's the value that we want to bring in, right? So we all talk about traceability all the time in blockchain, but traceability by itself does not mean anything. So I give you traceability, so what? So who is it benefiting? Who's you as a consumer get to know that, okay, fine, this milk is coming from this cow, or this spinach is coming from this farm. But unless I can put a value to traceability, you will not see the organized or the manufacturing sector of India putting their money in it. That's the first thing that we see, right? So the first biggest challenge that we work on is to identify the standards that the government will have to put in place, the certifications that a lot of these bodies who are giving these certifications, how do we transport that certification into digitizing it, first of all, and then having these certifications visible to the end consumers who are going to be consuming that food. The second part of it is, how do I reduce the freshness of the shelf life of the food itself? How do I increase that? Now, the second challenge, again, is very specific to India, because we don't have a lot of good warehouses which are affordable to a lot of farmers across the country, right? So that's again a cost which is very high. Now, if I need to get all these farmers or all these traders come onboarded on the solution and increase the overall shelf life of their product, somewhere the government will have to start thinking of putting these warehouses together, these reefer, especially refrigerated warehouses together across the country, which is going to eventually help us in increase the shelf life of the food products itself. The third part of it is about the third challenge that we have quite a bit in the subcontinent is about the counterfeit of the products itself. So how do you start thinking of reducing the counterfeit of the product? And then post that, how do you make sure that any product that is counterfeited has some legal action against it, or there are some liability to the organizations or the people who are not adhering to the standards that resulted in these counterfeits? So that's another play that the government will have to play. So eventually, government, again, across different countries that we've seen, is going to help you set these standards and give you some of the infrastructure that is required to put these technologies together. In the end of the day, because a lot of this industry is still controlled by private players, so your ecosystem players that we talk about have to be private players, and we have to start thinking of the value, and that's the focus area that we talk about as well, that what is the value that we can give, not just to the, you know, to the private industries or to the private players, but extend that value system to your farmers and your traders and your coffee growers and everybody who's there in this. Now, one of the value system that we keep thinking about is India. We manufacture quite a good amount of products, which is in higher category in terms of the quality of the product. But in an international market, we do not have that kind of exposure that is given to Indian food products. So how do you leverage solutions like blockchain to not just identify traceability, but use that traceability, extend it to creating a brand value for the food that is coming out of Indian market itself, right? And then take that brand value and convert it into a dollar value or a monetary value that can again trickle down to every player who is in the ecosystem today. So that's on the food industry. To your next question, Neeraj, which was about the inventory carrying cost of a blockchain solution. Now, and this is where the example that I was talking about earlier, where we are looking to create, and this is again a combination of two or three things, right? It is a combination of having your multiple layers of your supply chain come on the, or a multi-tier or a deep-tier supply chain come on the same network. And eventually when you start, and a lot of this is currently also being done in the industry, right? So if you look at vendor managed inventory. A lot of large organizations actually do vendor managed inventory, where eventually you're taking the cost out of cost of maintaining that warehouse, and you're the cost of carrying that inventory out of your own pocket, and you leave that in the vendor's pocket till you are consuming that product. But eventually at a point of time, the inventory carrying cost has not reduced, it's just shifted from point A to point B. So instead of me carrying that inventory cost, what I've done is I've left that inventory cost with the supplier, and I take that cost only once I know that I have requirement of that. And if you look at this model, this works very well with anybody who's a muscle in the industry, right? Or anybody, especially the large organizations where the vendors themselves would continue to carry this cost because of the benefit of the business opportunity that they get from these large organizations. This model doesn't work for smaller organizations or smaller manufacturing firms. Because in case of smaller manufacturing firms, the supplier's cost itself of creating, having that inventory lie carrying cost, the cost of the carrying that inventory for a certain manufacturer would not justify them holding onto inventory rather than passing it on to a different buyer. So in these cases, what we do is when you have tied the different layers of your supply chain on a single network, bringing all of that ecosystem together, the way it works is that now when I do my planning of how much I'm going to manufacture in a certain month, it trickles down to my fourth or fifth layer of that supply chain itself. So that means that the tier two who's going to do their planning will know that how much is my production plan. And their manufacturing is not just tied to the forecasting that we have received, but it is also tied directly to the production planning that is happening in a certain level. Eventually, when this keeps going down across an ecosystem, one of the biggest values that it starts unlocking is that across the ecosystem, you will see that the inventory carrying cost decreases. It is not just to do with a certain level, but this value kind of gets escalated across the different levels as well.
Sure. Thanks, Anup, for that. Kapil, your views on the blockchain adoption, as well as what will it take to kind of get that propagation done?
Yeah. So I think I echo what Anu said to a large extent, but I again feel that blockchain, as she said, when you look at food industry, so there is this whole concept of farm to shelf, right? So where was this produced? How did it move? At what temperature points, and finally delivered on a Walmart store, And then a customer picked it up, took it home. And then you realize there was something wrong with that fish that was kind of moving through this block and it has high mercury levels. Then how do you do a recall? Which is a challenge that a blockchain will solve easily, right? If you have it on a block, you can, you exactly know which customer picked that item and you can call them up and get it recalled, right? And manufacturing everywhere, there are use cases that Anu spoke about. A lot of them are practically being done already. And it's been a few years. I won't say something new. It's being done there. When you look at logistics, again, it's got its own benefits. So if implemented right, you know, blockchain for supply chain would offer better transparency, which in return, you know, will affect your overall logistics transparency. And this basically will help companies trust each other, you know, with more credibility. And by having this, there will be fewer invoice disputes or fewer worker exploitations, and there could be better auditing costs, right? That could be optimized. Again, how do you quantify it for a business to invest in it? I'll still question it, right? So if someone asks me to quantify and say, you have to spend X million dollars, can you justify this investment? It'll be hard. It'll be difficult for me to do. Right? Because a lot of these are kind of qualitative benefits too. What is the cost of litigation if a few folks die out of consuming poisoned food? I don't know. It's very difficult to predict, right? And whether that will happen or not is again something that's very difficult to predict. But where I feel this whole thing is going, Neeraj, is blockchain is one aspect of it. And I think if you look, put AI on top of it, right? So that's where that whole amalgamation of these two technologies will happen. For example, I'll give you an example. So today we talk about AI, and when we talk about AI, we talk about training data sets, right? Now imagine there is a doctor who has looked at my report and really doesn't understand it that well and probably wants an assistance from an AI system that is out there. And there are AI systems out there. I think Anu would be well aware. Watson was one that was trained on, you know, doing all these kind of medical health record, you know, training sets were done on that. So I, as a user, and, you know, and that doctor uses that, for example, and tells me that I need to take this pill because based on my report and millions of reports like that, the sample says that this medicine is the most effective. Now, as a user or as a, you know, patient, my first question of worry would be, what is this training data set? Does it, you know, where did this come from? Was it a big pharma training set? Or was it from an independent source of, you know, reports that it gathered, that kind of brought that inference together, right? So people will start, I think AI of tomorrow would penetrate into everything that we do. And then the bigger question for us would be, can I trust this AI, right? And for that to happen, the blockchain will play a key role, because you know that if the data is written on a block, it's immutable, but then you would question the source of data too. And you know that I can see what that source of data is based on which a qualified doctor is making an inference and, you know, kind of giving me a drug or giving me a prescription or giving me a medical procedure or recommending a medical procedure, right? So I think you'll see this amalgamation of the two technologies happening, and all these three, four emerging techs will immerse, or kind of, I would say, will play a crucial role and benefit each other for the real tech story to come out, right? And I think we're a few years ahead, or we few years behind actually, before we'll actually see and understand the data at that level. But again, as I said, blockchain is here to stay. The use cases right now have been in industries like banking, where it makes absolute ROI, right? So your auto clearances that happen between banks, it's a no-brainer. The moment you do it, transactions can be auto-reconciled without any person doing it. Earlier, I remember putting in a check and it used to take X number of days. Even clearing used to take a lot of time, 24 hours, 48 hours. So all of that has been solved by blockchain. Food has got a lot of use cases. There are benefits. Manufacturing has a lot of use cases. You know, the auto recalls can happen easily, or any other critical equipment, medical equipment recall can happen, right? That could result in a loss of life to a patient if not recalled at the right time, right? So these are cases in logistics. it's going to take some while, but I think if, like Anu said, once the norms and a little help from the government will help streamline it and kind of make this platform much more usable in the Indian context.
Sure, Kapil. I think Rajiv, if I come to you, I think what we see in the developed world is that the collaboration which is there between the industry and academia, is at a very different level. And when the government grants or support comes in as well, so the use case development we see happens in a very significant manner through this collaboration that is already existing between government, industry, and the academia. And then, of course, the propagation happens, from an industry user's perspective there. So do you see that, that is an area where more effort needs to get done to kind of propagate, uses of blockchain and, something similar, like new technology which are coming up there?
Sure. I'll not answer specific to blockchain, but broadly, I think, so for example, we do work with multiple academia. We do a lot of research work in different areas. I think where the government can really kind of help accelerate this, there is a lot of data that is available with the government, right? Especially when you look at the demand and supply patterns across the country, there is toll data that is available, there's aggregated e-way bill level data that is available with the government, right? So, and I know there are a lot of people especially in academia, they have the skills there, don't have any P&L pressures to solve problems, but purely, looking at fundamentally solving the problems. And typically the challenge there is always with data. So one of the things which happens when we work with them is that we provide that kind of source of data where they can actually experiment with kind of real world scenarios rather than just work on theoretical models, right? So I think there is a great scope, and we do see very good signs over there. For example, recently the government passed a policy which encourages or even stipulates a lot of departments to start sharing the GIS information collected by them to be used by different organizations in the private sector, right? So, I mean, especially Indian organizations. And similarly, I think there's a lot of data around, demand supply in the logistics area, which can really help the private sector also to kind of rise to the challenges more effectively. I think definitely that kind of global information can also very well align the efforts of the private sector. And with academia inputs, for example, I think it's already, again, something that's already taking place. Seniors of mine from college, for example, teach at the University of New South Wales, are now working directly with MORTH look at the entire logistics infrastructure, the planning of new hubs, planning of corridors, etc. So I think from a government side, in terms of the infra building, so academia can really contribute with them. And I see there's a growth in collaboration over there. And from a data perspective, I think there's a confluence of academia, industry, and government to really kind of, align those efforts in infra with the actual availability of supply to, better matching of supply and demand.
Sure. Kapil, if I come to you, changing gears a bit, in terms of reverse logistics that is there, what kind of innovations are you seeing in that area, now and also in the near future? What would be the expectations on changes that should be there from a reverse logistics perspective?
So reverse logistics, I think, again, has in our world too, it's kind of requires a different set of workflows. And, how we are kind of managing it. So we basically, as I said, we are a B2B company. But we also, like Rajiv said, we have group companies. So one of our group companies is Safe Educate, is into, logistics scaling program. So we work with academia, whether it's IIMs or IITs, and we do joint programs where we train supply chain people. A lot of them get jobs in Amazon and maybe delivery too, right? And we also do FTL and PTL business, and we do 3PL, 4PL as well. So reverse logistics within that function becomes really crucial. And the way, most of the systems used to handle it, there were always issues with how reverse logistics is handled within the systems, whether it's any SAP or, any TMS out there. So, and that has to be as easy and more, and the accountability there needs to be more. And the visibility has to be more for the consignor that is getting these reverse shipments back. So there was needs for certain approval workflows to be in place. There was need for some compliance, which is something that forced us to reimagine how reverse logistics will be done systematically. And I think we heard a lot of our customers having problems of how reverse logistics is handled in India. Whether it's the garment manufacturers, where the garments are returned back in boxes which are not travel worthy, and then the garments are missing in the transit and things like that, and a lot of that ownership comes to the logistics company or the carrier, right? So all of that required a different mindset and a different approach to design thinking in terms of putting that solution together. So I think we have kind of figured out how to do it, and that solutions are being rolled out with the customers now that are using reverse logistics capability with us. And I think going forward, most of the companies will have to relook at the way reverse logistics is done, because it was a practice that just kind of happened with most of these e-commerce companies spinning out. Suddenly reverse logistics is really very, very crucial and a sizable part of business in logistics today. And I think Rajiv would agree that it's a potential area, because it probably was not there maybe a decade back, right? But with the entire e-commerce, reverse is really plays an important role. Today you can return your good, and when a pickup boy is going to pick it up, and when the money will get credited back to your account. And the same level of expectation they are expecting from the business platforms also. So if I'm as a user of Amazon expect that kind of transparency, as a user of that service in B2B, I expect that level of transparency too. And we have built systems to kind of now take care of it, Neeraj.
Sure. And moving to another topic, let's cover the theme on, sustainability is an area which is of, growing interest. And, given the footprint, carbon footprint, which, logistics industry has, if you could kind of share, Rajiv, first with you, then Anu and Kapil, if you can share, let's say two examples or three examples, of areas where you see that sustainability is playing out as a major theme in your organization or in the industry, and then, something which is getting improved upon at the current time.
Thanks for that, Neeraj. So let me talk about a few aspects of thinking about sustainability, right? Again, it becomes a little more complicated for a company like ours, because we do not own, we are an asset-light company, right? We are working with a lot of facility providers, asset provider, resource provider, vehicle providers, etc., right? So from that perspective, one of the things, especially from a warehousing perspective, that immediately comes to mind is having renewable energy as part of those facilities, right? So we do work preferentially with people who do put up renewable energy solutions. However, from a pure payback perspective, for us to invest in something that is essentially a 20-year economic perspective doesn't always make sense. So instead, we try to think of it in two ways. One is how are we working towards reducing the number of kilometers each shipment is traveling, and also the utilization of a vehicle from a carbon footprint perspective, right? So what is the minimum carbon footprint for a package that is traveling through my network? How do we baseline it, and how do we keep reducing it over a period of time? So this is something in progress. It's fairly challenging given especially the kind of mix of products that we have. But I think that is one great way for logistics companies to start baselining the carbon footprint for every movement that they do and how they're moving across it over a period of time, right? That is one way for us to think about. The other thing is, of course, the big question of EV coming in, whether it is at the last mile or the mid mile. I think even from a technology perspective, there is still some evolution to go in terms of at least trucking solutions in India. There still needs to be tested out Similar, there are some challenges at the last mile as well. I mean, I think durability of the tech is something that for very commercial use is something that is still being tested. We have been investing in multiple pilots over a period of years, and we definitely see ourselves moving in that direction. We also have a lot of bicycle and foot soldiers that are doing our deliveries in an eco-friendly way. So that is another thing that we look at. We also partner with a lot of stores, especially for the parcel business, right? And those stores have their own bicycle-bound employees who go and do the deliveries, right? So to the store, we aggregate the shipments that need to be delivered by the store and provide it to them. And then the further deliveries happen on foot and bicycles. So broadly reducing the mode of transport where possible. EV is definitely going to be a very, very major lever in doing that. And I think we're watching closely both from a viability perspective in terms of whether they can take the wear and tear of like continued commercial use. And secondly, also in terms of the economics of it, I think there is not too much of a gap now, but there is a bit of a gap in terms of making electronic vehicles viable financially. However, I think we will still be going ahead and investing heavily in this. We have been investing in the R&D side, but even in terms of the adoption, we will definitely be one of the first people of the block in investing it. From a company perspective, we take sustainability very seriously. And I think logistics as an industry is, I think it's a great industry to set the benchmark for the rest of the economy in terms of sustainability initiatives.
Anu, if I come to you on the sustainability side, and we are kind of near to the end of the time, if you can just spend a minute and a half on like how technology can influence the sustainability element, as a theme within the logistics industry.
So I think the biggest component of sustainability in itself, Neeraj, is basically accountability and transparency, right? So when we talk about sustainability, and we've been talking about sustainability for more than a decade now. Government has tried putting a lot of standards and these regulations in place, but overall, where we have lacked is being able to set up accountability and creating that transparency in the market. Now, in this case, what we have seen, and we've seen this, we've worked on this across industries right now, whether it's your clothes manufacturer, logistics, irrespective of the organization that we talk about, the biggest, and this is especially happening in Europe quite a bit, right? So recently, United Nations in Europe have passed, I think, about 17 or 18, policies that they call it as sustainability growth plan. And a lot of organizations, including the logistics industry, has to adhere to that. Now, when we go into these discussions with UN, one of the biggest things that we found out that while these sustainability solutions have been thought of and have been detailed, the biggest challenge or the biggest roadblock that these organizations have been seeing is in being able to hold accountability. Now, for those of you who understand blockchain, one of the basic premises on which blockchain works is it's very easy to establish accountability in terms of where that data is coming from. So if I have a participants of an ecosystem who are engaging on the same platform, then for me to be able to achieve that sustainability goal in terms of the overall carbon footprint from a network, et cetera, becomes easier because there is an accountability that is not just limited to the larger organization, but gets spread across the ecosystem itself.
Sure. Thanks, Arun, for that. So Kapil, if I come to you, we are almost to the, out of time now, but in terms of, we have a couple of minutes. If you can just share in terms of, your view on the sustainability, basically coming in more from technology perspective, and also in terms of, there was one of the questions which I wanted to ask earlier was in terms of, the usage of the electric vehicles. Rajiv did allude to that. But in terms of, there is a question from the audience as well in terms of, that if somebody is into the EV rental business from a commercial perspective, how what are the kind of things that they should watch out for?
Okay, yeah. So I think, I'll touch upon sustainability quickly in two areas. One is the technology side, the other is the non-tech side. So we basically, Neeraj, have about 50 odd mega hubs across India, which are owned by us. And all of them are sustainable structures. By sustainable, what I mean is that they're all green buildings, and they're designed in a way that you have most natural light. So the use of, and they're done in a cross-docking way that there's a lot of ventilation too, right? So, and then as a part of that structure, since there are multi-acre setups, we do a lot of plantations there to make sure that we follow the green norms. And most of these buildings are green certified as well. So that's one part of it. Also from the trucking side, we, as you know, Rajiv said, we are also an asset light company. So although we have dedicated fleet of vendors, so if we have say 7,000 transshipment vehicles, then they are dedicated vendors fleet for us with our logo and our branding, right? So they can't do business for anyone else. So a lot of these vehicles are, again, you know, as a policy, 5 to 7 years, we ask them to replace it, so that that's when the vehicles start polluting a lot and we make sure that they comply with the norms. And as for the battery, I think once that, we have already launched e-rickshaws in few of the locations, which is for the last mile deliveries. And so these are e-scooters kind of a thing, a three-wheeler, which is designed and has a branding and is being used for deliveries. Then coming to the tech side, Neeraj, so in the last few years, we have digitized everything. So recently we digitized the gate pass. So that helped us save about 14 million sheets of A4 paper a year, which is equal to 800 trees, right? So, and there were a lot of these exercises, right? So that's where we see that, how can we reduce the use of paper? Because paper is being, was being used, and again, more than industry, it's the demand of the customer. The customer's used to that. So we always try to see how can we be the first movers and try to change or influence the industry. Because of a sheer size, I think we, it is our social responsibility towards the environment to educate the customer and have them get onto the digital bandwagon. And it's not easy for a lot of these customers. But the moment you put the environment angle to it, some of these conversations become easier and we see a lot of support from the customers coming in. So I think the last 2 years, we have literally digitized everything. And all the paper printouts have been kind of reduced. As I said, the latest one being saving about, 800 to 1,000 odd trees. And I think we keep on doing these kind of endeavors so that our overall environmental print is, print is less, and we are able to optimize on the natural resources that are available to us.
No, wonderful. And I would, with this, I think, I draw the session to a close. Thank you very much, Kapil, Anu, and Rajiv. I think we had a kind of wide-ranging discussion on various elements of technology adoption at the current time, as well as in terms of some of the disruption and the challenges, and what we should be exciting that we should be looking forward to. And I think sustainability theme is something which is close to every one of us, and we look forward to greater adoption of technology in this area. As you kind of look at the further growth to happen in this industry, there. With this, I'll bring the session to a close. We, of course, could not touch upon, there were several more questions as well, which were, there posed by the audience as well. I think we spent like the last 1.5 hours dealing with some of those topics around it, but there are a few more questions on blockchain. There are in terms of users, in terms of aviation aspect of it, also some on the logistics policy, and also in terms of, a couple of specific ones in terms of the cost element of it as well. I would request Siddharth, that you kind of, probably take on some of this as a separate session at some other time there. So with this, I thank very much all of you for your time, and to the audience as well for their participation in this webinar today. Siddharth, over to you.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much. Such an insightful and engaging conversation. Everybody's been hooked, and a real privilege to hear you all. I'm getting messages on my WhatsApp. We've got messages from readers on the Blue Circle app thanking you all for being here today. And thank you to the leaders in the audience also for always joining in large numbers, for staying till the end, and for always sharing excellent questions. For the questions that may not have been addressed due to paucity of time, I will share the relevant ones with the leaders on the panel and request some of their time for it. We will also try to post the answers in the community app as well, as suggested by Mr. Bansal. Along with our weekly webinars and our publication, we're taking these discussions and conversations on the exclusive app, which is curated for senior leaders across 6 sectors that are logistics, e-mobility, energy, real estate, aerospace and defense, and healthcare. So whether you would like to engage with us on our platform, leaders are invited to join the logistics circle and also get access to the other allied industry circles that we're building. I've also shared the app link in the chat box and will be emailing the select leaders in the audience. So thank you very much, sirs and ma'am, once again. We look forward to having more such discussions in the future, and please stay safe.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.